Take your Bible this evening, if you will, and open it to Genesis chapter 12. Genesis chapter 12, if you would. Genesis chapter 12, we're going to read the first five verses there, and I've got a five-minute sermon, but I'll stretch it a little bit, okay? No, I was just kidding. Genesis chapter 12. Verse 1, the Bible said, "Now the Lord had said unto Abram, Get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed." So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. And Abram took Sarai his wife, and Lot his brother's son, and all their substance that they had gathered, and the souls that they had gotten in Haran, and they went forth to go into the land of Canaan, and into the land of Canaan they came. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, help us tonight. Lord, help me to be a blessing. Encourage us, Lord, where we need encouragement, and Lord, straighten us where we need to be straightened. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I think the greatest problem we face today when we read the Bible is not the lack, or is not the lack of ability to understand it. Some people say, "Well, I just can't understand it." I really don't buy that argument. Okay, I've heard numerous times that the King James Bible is really written on about a sixth grade reading level, and so surely you can read on a sixth grade reading level. All right, you can do that. Now we've got a couple in here that may not quite be there yet. All right, but other than that, you can read on that level, and you can understand it. I think the problem is our failure to think about what we read.
Come on, amen.
To think about what we read. We have a Bible reading calendar. We're reading now. If you're with us, you're reading in the book of Leviticus.
Amen.
And the book of Leviticus, when you read it, it's not, I confess, it's not the most exciting reading. When I was a kid and I was looking to read in the scriptures, I didn't go to Leviticus, all right? I'd go to the book of Judges maybe and read there, but I didn't go to the book of Leviticus. But our problem is we read the Bible, but we really don't, I think much about what we read. And I've said to you repeatedly, if you're reading the Bible, I would rather you read just a few verses and really ponder what those verses are saying than to read five chapters and get nothing.
Amen.
But we need to think about what we're reading. And because we don't think about it, then we don't realize, we don't consider. For instance, we read here about Abraham. We read about Abraham, we thought, man, yeah, he's a great man, a great giant of the faith, and we just go on and on. But the truth of the matter is we forget he was a person just like us.
Amen.
He's a person just like us. Now, he lived in a different day. He didn't have an air-conditioned car. All right? I understand that. But still, he was an individual just like you and I are individuals. He had the same kind of concerns. He had the same kind of fears. He had the same kind of problems we face. We deal with them. And he did the same thing. Well, I want to use these scriptures tonight. I want to preach to you about the subject of facing the unknown. Facing the unknown. God asked Abraham to face the unknown. Look, if you will, there, all right? What he says, he says, "I want you to get thee out of thy country, from thy kindred, from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee."
Yeah.
No land. Now, wait a minute.
Yeah.
Can I say this? Abraham wasn't any spring chicken when this came down.
No, sir.
He was 75 years old.
Right.
Now, I realize he was going to live longer than probably most of us are going to live, all right? But still, he was no young man.
No.
We're talking to a fellow in the middle age, and God comes along to him and says, "I want you to get up, I want you to leave where you're living, and I want you to leave your people, and I want you to go where I show you to go." He wanted him to go somewhere where Abraham never been. Truth of the matter is, Abraham didn't even know where he was going to be sent. He couldn't look it up on TripAdvisor.
Yeah.
Say, what is that? I'm not real sure, but I've heard about it, okay? No, people look on TripAdvisor to look at things and to check things out. He couldn't Google it. Didn't know where he was going. I'm telling you, it was often the unknown. Wait a minute, he had a wife.
Amen.
He had a wife. He had friends.
Oh, yes.
He's being uprooted from all of that. Now, wait just a minute, all right? Let me give you something else to consider. We live in the day of instant communication.
Right.
Instant communication.
Amen.
My wife and Mrs. Whitaker FaceTime each other. How many of you don't know what that is? FaceTime each other. I don't really either, all right? But anyway, they do it, and they can not only talk to each other on their phone, but they can see each other. And so they sit down, and I come peek around sometimes and say, yep, that's her, all right. But wait a minute, they're in Belize.
Right.
You couldn't do that in that day. I remember when I was a kid, my mom and her mom, we lived in Georgia. Her mom and dad lived in Southeast Texas.
Yep.
At best, that was an all-day trip.
Yes, sir.
To get there.
Yes, sir.
And they wrote back and forth. They actually, you're not gonna believe this, but they put stuff on paper.
Amen.
All right, they wrote it out on paper, folded it up, put it in an envelope, put a stamp on it, mailed it. All right. So why didn't they just go long distance? Well, no, you don't understand how expensive that was in that day.
Amen.
Now, you didn't just pick up the phone. It wasn't like it is today, unlimited long distance.
No.
All right, here, Abraham's fixing to get up and go to a land that the Lord would show him. He didn't know where he was going. He's launching out into the unknown, if you will, leaving his family, leaving his friends. Listen, he had business dealings. He's leaving all the people he's done business with. He was being asked to leave. He was being asked to change a huge, make a huge change in his life. If that was asked of us today, I'm telling you, it wouldn't be as difficult as it was for Abraham because of the day we live in. But he was facing the unknown. Now, you and I today, we face the unknown. Things come up in life. The future's uncertain. My wife and I last night, I told you, we met Lamont's daughter and talked to her, and she told us, she said, I don't really know what's coming. Hey, the future's uncertain.
Amen.
Future's uncertain. She said, don't know what to expect. But the truth of the matter is, you and I don't know what's coming.
Amen.
We have no idea. We really don't know what's going to take place tomorrow, all right? Maybe there's health problems, health issues. Maybe there's surgery out there on the horizon. I don't know about you, but when I've had surgery coming up, I was never really excited.
No, sir, can't help you.
Never really excited. Isn't it fun to be there? They've got you all prepped. They've got that IV stuck in you somewhere. And then they hand you this sheet of paper explaining all the things that could go wrong.
Amen.
Would you sign that? Man, where am I going? I'm stuck here, right? Hey, it's uncertain. We don't know what's going to happen. Could be layoffs at work. Think, man, I've got a secure job. No, we don't know that. We don't know that. Hey, you and I, we don't know what Christians are going to be called on to face in the days ahead.
Amen.
Man, we live in a day where the tide's turning and
yes,
the approval from those that believe in God and those that really are serious about their faith and really believe that the Bible means what it says. You and I are not looked at with wonderful eyes. Hey, we're kind of looked at a little bit suspiciously. They don't really care for us. There's the possibility of the call of God. If God puts his call on your life and he calls you to full-time service, maybe he calls you to be a preacher. He calls you to be a missionary. He calls you to go and take the gospel. You say, wait a minute, I don't know where that's going. Yeah, God calls us to face the unknown. I tell you what, death's one of those great unknowns.
Yes, sir.
So I ask you, how can you face the unknown? How can you face the unknown? Let me show you what Abraham did, all right? I want you to see what he did. Go with me to Hebrews chapter 11. Israel preacher, you can quit preaching now. We know what you're going to preach. Well, good, I want you to listen, all right? Don't get ahead of me. Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. Notice there in verse 8. Notice what the Bible says. By faith.
Come on.
Verse 8.
Mm-hmm.
Hebrews chapter 11, verse 8, by faith. But wait a minute, I want you to back up to verse 1. The Bible says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Can I say this to you? The unknown is essential to what faith is. The unknown is essential to what faith is. Things hoped for, things not seen.
Amen.
That is a great part of the essence of faith. It deals with the unknown. Deals with the unknown. We're called upon to have that faith. Abraham's called to go in a foreign country. So what did he do? He believed God. He believed God. Look there in verse 8 again. All right. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for inheritance, obeyed, and he went out not knowing whether he went. He simply believed God.
Amen.
He simply trusted God for what he could not see or could not know. I have dealt with two people and two situations in the last about 3 or 4 days of people that have sat down with me and they really don't want to have faith in God. Or one of them in particular. I'll back off of that. One of them really didn't want to have faith in God. They really wanted to blame God and say, why should I trust him because of these things that have happened to me? They really didn't want to have faith in God. But what God tells us is, if we're going to be able to make a success in this life, if you're going to be able to face the unknown, the way to face it is simply believe God and trust him.
Amen.
Trust him for what you can't see and what you don't know. Just trust him. You say, well, I just can't do that. Sure you can. We trust all kinds of folks.
Amen.
We trust all kinds of folks. We trust people that call us on the phone we've never seen.
Right.
We trust them. We take our car down to a dealer or we take our car down to a repair person and we trust them. You say, no, I go to my mechanic and I got gears. But wait a minute, there was a first time you ever took it there.
Right. Amen.
You put your trust in somebody you did not know.
That's
yeah, well, so-and-so recommended him. Yeah, you ever been recommended to somebody and you wonder, what was wrong with that lying rascal that recommended
Amen.
This guy?
Oh,
yes.
Amen.
Yeah, we have. I'm saying to you, we've trusted. What's wrong with trusting God?
Amen.
Just putting our faith and our trust in him and just trusting him to take care of things Amen. For what I can't see, what I cannot know, I'm just going to trust him.
Right.
Just going to trust him. Nearly 36 years ago, I stood here. I stood here. Her wife and he stood there. And we became husband and wife.
Right.
And I just trusted God that it was going to work out.
Yeah.
You said, well, did you pray? Yes, I prayed.
Yeah.
But I didn't know how it was going to work out. I didn't know how the things were going to come out. I know that. I thought I knew her. Found out I didn't. That's the way most of us are. We get married, we marry somebody, we think we know them, but we find out, well, I just thought I knew her. Now, that's not a bad thing. We just knew the little surface, but we found out we didn't know. But I'm telling you, what I did is I trusted God.
Amen.
I trusted God.
Right.
And I trusted him to get us through some things. Man, what a different world it would be if we could just get to the point where we'd believe God. Just believe. Say, preacher, I believe him. Yeah, but. We read things in the Word of God. This is his word. This is his book. And we get to things and we go, I'm not sure about that. Oh, we wouldn't maybe voice it outwardly. But by the way we live, what we're telling people is, you know, I'm not sure I can believe God. No, okay, I can trust him for my salvation. Hey, wait a minute. You remember what Peter said when the Lord said, will you also go away?
Yeah.
Peter said, well, Lord, whom should we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life.
Amen.
The truth of the matter is, when it comes to eternal life, there's no other option.
Amen.
Oh, you can get out there with religion, but it's not going to do you any good. When it comes to eternal life, he's the only choice.
Amen.
Only choice. But we look at other things that come up in life and we think, well, I've got other options. I don't just have to believe God. I can go check out other options. I can go investigate some things. Well, what a difference it'd make if we just get to the point where we just believe God. Abraham couldn't, I've already said it, he couldn't go online and check out where he was going. First of all, he didn't know where he was going.
Right. Amen.
Believe he knew where he was going until he got there. And God said, this is it. This is it. He said, you go to a land where I'll show thee.
That's right.
So you just pick it up, pack it up, come on, we're going. Can you imagine telling your wife, man, all right, we're moving. Where to? I don't know. No. Just pack up, we're going. Yeah, you've done it. Well, most other people haven't, all right? You haven't done that. You say, wait a minute, where are we going to? Well, I don't know. Well, I'm not packing until I know where I'm going. Well, that was the situation Abraham dealt with. But he believed God. He believed God. Listen, he faced the unknown by faith, and I'll be honest with you, that's the only way we can do it. He overcame the unknown by just obedience. Look there again in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 8, would you? Notice the wording. Notice what the Bible tells us. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for inheritance, obeyed. Obeyed. Hey, that's the way he overcame the unknown. Just simple obedience. Can I tell you, faith is more than just some feeling?
Amen.
It's more than just some feeling. It's a force that should compel us to act.
Amen.
Preacher, when the Bible says this, what should I do? What the Bible says.
Amen.
What the Bible says. I think it was Jack Hiles one time said he won this fellow to the Lord, and the fellow said, okay, I'm getting saved. What's next? He said, well, I need to get baptized. Well, all right, I'll get baptized. He got baptized. He said, what's next? Yep. And man, he went down the line with him. And somebody got funny because he got to one point. He said, what's next? And he said, well, you need to give a tithe. He said, well, what's that? He said, well, that's a tenth. And the guy said, well, I don't know anything about a tenth, but I got 2/5 under the front seat of my car.
Yeah.
That's not the same thing, okay? It's not the same thing. But you know what? Really and truly, don't you think that ought to be our attitude before God?
Right.
Lord, what do you want me to do? Okay, I did that. What's next? What's next? Am I doing everything you want me to do? Why? Because we got faith in Him. Faith in Him. Look in James chapter 2. James chapter 2. If you're there in Hebrews, just the next book after. Hebrews, the book of James. James chapter 2, verse 20. James chapter 2, verse 20. But look thou, O vain man, that faith without works is dead. Verse 23, and the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. Why? Because he did something.
Amen.
He didn't just have a feeling. He took some action.
Amen.
He trusted God, but that faith compelled him to take some action. Listen, that's what our faith is to do. It's to be translated into works.
Right.
It produces some works. It's not a matter of us saying, well, I believe God. I believe you. I believe you. Okay, good. What are you doing? To show you believe. What are you doing to show you believe that? That you're really following Him. The truth of the matter is, Abraham conquered the unknown by taking care of that which was known. All right, now you stop and think about that a second. He conquered the unknown by taking care of what was known. He said, well, what did he know? He knew that God said to him, get up and get going.
Right.
So he got up and he got going. And he went where God told him to go. He followed the direction of God. Look in 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4, would you look down, if you would, in verse 8. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8. For bodily exercise profiteth little, but godliness is profitable unto all things.
Right.
Notice, having promise of the life that now is, that's present, and of that which is to come. That which is to come. Godliness. It has some promise of the life that now is. Godliness. Putting ourselves into the point where we obey God. That's the way you develop godliness, all right? It's not something that just comes on you one day when you wake up. That's the flu. It comes on you, all right? No, we're not talking about that. That's not the way godliness comes, as you begin to do what God says for you to do. You obey Him. And it's going to have to be by faith, because you're going to look at it and you're going to say, I can't see how that'll work out. That's right. That's why you just got to obey Him by faith. Amen. Just got to do it by faith. Trusting Him. Conquering that unknown. I don't know where this is going to lead. I don't either. But if God's leading, it doesn't matter. It'll be okay. Amen. It'll be all right. It'll be where He wants me to be. Godliness is produced in our life that way. And it gives promise, you know, of the life that now is. But wait a minute. Of that which is to come. I don't know if you ever stop and think about it, but life is always the preparation for death. Amen. It's a preparation for death. You say, well, I'm not looking forward to that. Well, I'm hoping to go in the rapture. Amen. Right? Amen. I'm hoping it'll be in the rapture, but I don't have that knowledge for sure it's going to be there. So we prepare for that life to come. And that godliness is involved in every area of our life. Every area of our life. All of those things, we develop them. God calls upon us to give up things. And we're questioned, well, man, what am I going to do if I give that up? How am I going to? It'll be all right.
Right.
It'll be all right.
Right.
But I don't understand. I know, you don't see. I know, but that's faith. That's faith. And it's just being obedient to God. Hey, what are you facing out there in life that's unknown? What are you facing out there in life that's unknown? I don't know what's maybe coming. There's that future out there, and you think, well, I got it all figured out. Wait a minute. Go back to Hebrews chapter 11. Go back to Hebrews chapter 11. We face some unknowns. We think we've got it all figured out. We think, man, I've got it all planned. I got my life all laid out step by step. Every time I get to this point in something like this, I think back to a paper I wrote when I was in the fifth grade and possessed with all wisdom.
Amen.
As a fifth grade. And the teacher gave us an activity that's a little bit goofy to give to a fifth grader, because they said, you know, it was, what are you planning to do in life? Well, hopefully get to the sixth grade. You know, you're asking a fifth grader. But I remember taking that piece of paper, and I had all these plans, and I wrote out what I was going to do. Wrote out everything, you know. I said, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this, and I could tell you those things because I still remember many of them. I wrote them out. But the main thing is this. I didn't do a single one of those things. None of those things that I wrote on that paper as a fifth grader have I done. None of those things. Okay, you say, well, you should have. No. I had no idea what God was going to do in my life when I was in the fifth grade.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 11. Would you look at verse 11? Through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed, and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Therefore sprang there even of one, and him as good as dead, so many as the stars of the sky in multitude, and as the sand which is by the seashore innumerable. Now, could I remind you of what God told Abraham in Genesis chapter 12? Can I remind you of what God told Abraham? God told Abraham, He said, you get up, you go to the land where I show thee, and He said, I'm going to make of you a great nation. Now, wait a minute. He's telling that to a man 75 years old.
Right.
75 years who had no children.
Right. Amen.
He got to be 85. He had no children.
That's right.
All right. He noticed something. I don't know if you've noticed this, you that are married. Have you noticed, men, as you age, so does your wife? I know that's profound, right?
Amen.
Yeah, we all age. Okay? Abraham's watching that going on. Now, we know the Bible. We know what happened. We know Sarah said, Abraham, look, obviously God needs our help.
Yes, oh yes.
So we got to figure it out. I'm going to give you Hagar, my maid, and you can have children by, and you know, we can help God out.
Oh, yes.
God didn't need any help.
Amen, sir.
God just needed faith. He just needed obedience.
Right.
Just needed obedience. But what I want you to see is this. Our faith will not only help in the present, but it'll fix the future.
Yes.
It'll fix the future. Faith assures us that what He's promised, He will perform.
Right.
Now, we get a little impatient sometimes. We get a little impatient. We think, okay, Lord, I've given you a couple of days now. When's this going to happen? Or even a couple of years. When's this going to take place? That's what happened to Abraham and Sarah. They decided God needs our help. No, He didn't. He just needed them to be faithful. He just needed them to obey Him. And folks, can I say this to you? That's what God needs us to do.
Amen.
God needs us to take this book and consider what God has said to us. And read it like He means it. And then say, Lord, if that's what You want me to do,
Amen.
I'll do it. I'll do it. Abraham got the call of God. He didn't go around the land where he was living and take a poll and say, do y'all think I should do that? I guarantee you there were people in that day that would have said, Abraham, you're a fanatic.
Right.
What in the world are you thinking? You know, you've lost your mind. He didn't take a poll. He didn't check it out. He didn't add up all the things. The Bible said he just obeyed. Man, if we just learned to do that.
Amen.
If we just learned to, by faith, do what God says for us to do. Just step out, trust Him, and you say, well, I don't know what's coming. That's the way you take care of the unknown. You believe God. You believe Him, you trust Him. You trust Him. I don't know about you, but when I was 9 years old, I trusted Him to save my soul.
Right.
I trusted Him to save my soul. As a teenager, I trusted Him, and when He put His call on my life, I surrendered to Him.
Amen.
I didn't try to look ahead and figure out how it would all turn out. I didn't try to do that. And hey man, as a teenager, I was shy. I didn't like to meet people. I didn't like to talk to strangers. And everybody's a little bit strange, all right?
Amen.
I didn't like to do those things. But I didn't stop to consider that when God called. The truth of the matter is, I was one of those kind of back here, you know, said, Lord, would You use me? Would You call me? I never thought about how things were going to work out. I didn't know how that would be. But God was faithful, and He's always been faithful. He will always do what He's promised. You can count on Him. He'll perform that.
Amen.
What we need to do, just trust Him. Just trust Him. Well, look, you've got a problem here in the doctor's office. Doctor sits down and says, well, you know, I just want to tell you, it doesn't look good. Don't know how this thing's going to be, you know, it doesn't look good, though. So what do? Listen, I tell you, the child of God trusts God.
Amen.
You just trust God. Now, I want to say this to you. That does not mean everything will turn out the way you necessarily wanted it to turn out. But it does mean it will be all right. Because you trusted God and you left it in His hands. You left it in His hands. You know, the truth is, when do you get to the point where you're willing to say, okay, Lord, it's all right. You can go ahead and take my spouse. That's all right. Go ahead. And it's not going to get to that point where you're excited about doing that. It's difficult to get to that, face that situation. But on the other hand, God didn't promise eternal life here. He just promised eternal life. Promised eternal life. Folks I were talking to in the last few days, they said, I'm so tired of hearing somebody tell me my loved one's in a better place. So I'm not going to tell you that.
Amen.
But I am going to tell you this. If they're a child of God, then God's in control.
Right.
God was in control of what happened, and it didn't have to happen the way you wanted. But we have to trust God. So, preacher, that's easy for you to say you've never faced. Wait a minute, you don't know what I faced.
Right.
You don't know what I faced. Hey, I've stood by the bedside of some folks dying that, you know, I didn't want to see them pass. I didn't want to see them. Not somebody who was well up in years and was feeble. And no, I mean folks that were young. I don't want to see them pass. But wait a minute, I learned a long time ago, the thing for me to do is trust God.
Amen.
The thing for you to do is trust God. It's for us to walk by faith. We face that unknown. You know, the truth of the matter is, as a Christian, surely you look forward to heaven. Surely you look forward to heaven. Now, that doesn't mean anybody saying, Lord, come get me today. Most of us not in a big hurry to go. But wait a minute, we look forward to going. And we know a little bit about what the Bible says about heaven. But it's that passage from this life to there that's unknown.
Right. Amen. Amen.
It's not so much death as it is dying. Can I say this to you? When you face that, trust God. Just keep trusting God. Just keep trusting Him. You know, there's a chorus that, man, I used to love to sing to the teenagers. I just keep trusting my Lord.
Amen.
As I walk along.
Yes, sir.
I just keep trusting my Lord. And he gives a song, though the storm clouds darken the sky over the heavenly, you know, can't remember the next word, over the heavenly veil, maybe.
Trail.
That's it. I just keep trusting my Lord. He will never fail. He's a faithful friend, such a faithful friend. You know, it's easy to sing that when all the sun's shining, things are going wonderful. But I'm going to tell you, it's just as true when the clouds hang low in life and the storms are there. It's just as true. And you have to face the unknown. Say, how do you do it? By faith. By faith. How do you conquer the unknown? By obedience. Just obey God. Just obey Him. It'll fix the future. It'll fix the future. Would you bow your heads tonight, every head bowed and every eye closed? Listen, I don't know maybe tonight what you may be facing. I don't know what's in front of you. Maybe there's some sitting here and you've been struggling with some things. They're unknown, but you really don't know. I mean, you say, preacher, I don't know. It's unknown. I'm not sure what's out there. What should I do? Trust God. Obey Him. Just follow His leadership. Would you do that? Would you just determine in your heart, hey, I'm going to keep doing that. Maybe you've been doing that. Good. I'm going to keep doing that. You bet. Good. Good. Just keep trusting. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know either. But I'm trusting God. I believe in Him. He'll do that. He'll do that. You can conquer the unknown. You'll just do it. Heavenly Father, I pray for you. Lord, help us. We're weak. We're feeble. Lord, we have fears because we're human. Sometimes, Lord, we have doubts. But Lord, help us to trust you. Help us, Lord, to exercise that faith. That same faith that would save us is the same faith, Lord, that will sustain us in life. Through the unknown things that come, Lord, just help us to be faithful to you. Help us to obey Him, to seek in our lives to have a godly life that's patterned after you and is what you want us to be. Lord, I pray that you just help us to dwell on that, to labor for it and say, I'm just going to exercise my faith. I'm going to trust you. I'm going to live for you. And Lord, I'll let you take care of it. or the unknowns out there, from time to time, all of us are going to face it. The Lord helps us to realize that we can conquer the unknown by obedience through faith. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you tonight. It's good to have you here. You're dismissed.